must agree that they intend to arbitrate the dispute and do not wish to resolve their disputes through traditional means of litigation, either through courts or any other form of judicial tribunal or an authority constituted under any law. And the second important aspect of arbitration is that, like litigation, it also involves the process of adjudication. So an arbitrator, very similar to that of a judge of a court of law, would adjudicate on the rights and obligations of the parties, and the consequences or the culmination of these events is that an arbitral tribunal, like a national court or a judicial tribunal, would pass an award or a judgment, as you would call it in a court of law. So unlike, say, any other, say, a legislative decree or any other form of authority, an arbitral dispute primarily involves adjudication, and such adjudication results in a final and binding award. To say that we have agreed to arbitrate would naturally mean that the parties agreed to be bound by the award and agree that the award is final and binding between them. And then the basis of an arbitral process is an arbitration agreement. And to define an arbitration agreement is, or to say that an arbitration agreement shall be in this form, is laid out in the statutes, which I will be going into. But if you want to arbitrate, or if a party wants to arbitrate, you can have a one-word arbitration agreement. You can just say in a commercial contract that you wish to arbitrate, and that is good enough. But of course, it is not advisable. And you will also see in such, in complex transactions, say a merger or a share purchase, or depending on the complexity of the transaction that is taking place, that there are arbitration agreements which are pages long. So neither of such an arbitration agreement is advised, either a one-word arbitration agreement or even a 3-4 page long arbitration agreement. It is always important to have a precise arbitration agreement defining the rights of the parties to either to say appoint an arbitrator, etc., which is more advisable. And you can, traditionally in these days that we see is that in commercial contracts, people do not arbitrate their disputes before an ad hoc arbitral tribunal, but they prefer to have an institutional arbitration governing the resolution of their disputes. So we have, say, the ICC or any other international institutional arbitration mechanism whereby parties could resolve their disputes. And moving on, I think what we need to remember is that an arbitration is not intended to be an expert determination of the disputes. Of course, it is possible that, say, in a construction arbitration, you would have an engineer as the arbitrator to resolve your disputes. Or say in a complex share purchase transactions, that you may have an accountant who acts as the arbitrator. But the intention of an arbitration is not an expert determination, but an expert determination may be a part and parcel of such a dispute resolution mechanism that the people have chosen. And it is also not to be confused with a forum selection agreement that is usually found in commercial contracts. It is not to say that the parties will resolve their disputes in a particular court of law or in that particular court of law. It is basically agreeing that we will not be resolving our disputes through traditional dispute resolution mechanisms such as before a court of law, and that we would be doing it before a private tribunal, which is called an arbitral tribunal. And there are a few reasons why parties wish to arbitrate. It's because, say, for example, in an international commercial arbitration, in an international commercial arbitration where the commercial underlying commercial contract is between parties belonging to different nations or different states, it is obvious in the interest of one of the parties that he does not arbitrate or have his dispute resolved in any other jurisdiction apart from his own jurisdiction. So there is a element of surprise. He doesn't know how the legal system of that particular country works. So an arbitration agreement for resolution of disputes brings in that element of neutrality so that parties are aware even at the time of getting into a contract, a commercial contract, as to how, what is the nature of dispute resolution that they are going to be faced with once a dispute arises. And as far as the domestic arbitration is concerned, in the Indian scenario, all of us know that our courts are clogged with cases. There are about, I think, 30 million cases that are pending right now. And with such pendency of cases and judicial delays, of course, it is not in anyone's commercial and best commercial interest to litigate a dispute, because you do not know how uncertain or how uncertain the as far as time or as to the verdict or as the result of the litigation is going to be. So arbitration brings in that element of certainty to the dispute resolution, one as regards time and also as regards what you expect out of the arbitration. So you may have, say, a national court judge who is not well versed with construction disputes or say any other, say, software licensing disputes. It is always better that you have your disputes resolved by a person who you think who you would trust for the purposes of resolution of your disputes. So it brings in that amount of certainty as regards the final verdict, also as regards the time taken to resolve that dispute. So these are some of the important reasons why commercial parties especially choose to arbitrate in country. And as far as international commercial arbitration is concerned, it is because of reasons such as neutrality, etc., that parties wish to arbitrate and not subject themselves to the conflict of law rules, which is quite anyway one of the complex subjects of private international law. And so on today's session I'm going to divide my speech into two parts. One is where I will be focusing on the arbitration aspect of what happens under the arbitration law, and one is the court aspect, where, because to have some legitimacy to the arbitral process, we have our laws in place and there is some sanctity attached to an arbitral process whereby courts are designated to do their own function for an effective implementation of the arbitral system in India. So my second part of the speech is going to be about the court processes surrounding an arbitration mechanism. And I'll primarily deal with the Indian scenario under the Arbitration and Conciliation Act of 1996. So as soon as we talk about arbitration, the first thing is, how do we commence an arbitration? So since we are all lawyers today who are present here, a case is commenced with the filing of a case. You present the case before the court and your case is assumed to be filed. But how do you commence an arbitration? So Section 21 of the Arbitration Act comes to our rescue and it says that if either of the parties to the arbitration agreement or to the dispute sends a written communication to the other party seeking resolution of disputes to arbitration, and if such a communication is received by the other party and on such date, the arbitration process is deemed to have commenced. And once an arbitration process is commenced, so your period of limitation starts to run. So generally in any commercial matter, the limitation period to commence a legal proceeding is 3 years. So if someone has had a cause of action arisen, say about 3 years prior to the receipt of the communication in terms of Section 21, so that date is going to be the reckoning date for the purposes of computing limitation. it's very important for every legal practitioner to be aware of when the arbitration process commences so that technical issues of limitation, etc. are avoided at a later stage. Once an arbitration process is commenced, the next process is to constitute the arbitral tribunal or the panel of arbitrators or the arbitral forum, which will decide and adjudicate upon the rival claims and contentions of the parties. So now, as far as a sole arbitrator, so under the Arbitration Act, you could either have a sole arbitrator or you could have three arbitrators or more in multiples of such. You can have three, you can have five. So that in the case of a tie, there is one umpire who is able to resolve the conflict between such arbitrators. So as far as sole arbitration is concerned, and if the arbitration agreement provides for a sole arbitrator, the parties will have to agree upon it as to who will be the sole arbitrator. And in the event that parties are unable to agree on the appointment of a sole arbitrator, there are some recourses mentioned, which I will go in the later aspect of my presentation today. And once an arbitral tribunal is constituted, like a court proceeding, we have our basics of filing pleadings. Say a claimant will have to file a claim statement. The respondent or the defendant would file his statement of defense. And once the pleadings are completed, parties would be at liberty to lead any evidence if they wish to lead any oral evidence. Or if the nature of the dispute is such that it can be decided without oral evidence, the arbitral tribunal would proceed and decide the matter in accordance with the pleadings and documents filed by the parties. In my experience as a practitioner, I have not been at the bar for about 6 years now, and I've seen that mostly arbitrations are do not require oral evidence unless it's a very complex matter and you need to really prove few things on the basis of oral evidence. Otherwise, arbitrations are quite fairly simple to be decided on the basis of the documents that the parties adduce and on the basis of the pleadings. But there is one aspect that we may have to look at apart from the regular process of dispute resolution before an arbitration tribunal is an interim relief. So let us go to interim relief. There are two aspects to it. One is there is Section 9 of the Arbitration Act and there is Section 17 of the Arbitration Act, which provide for interim reliefs for a party. So an interim relief is usually claimed by a party if the party feels or if the party has some apprehensions as to the as to any of the acts that the other party may involve in, which is going to prejudice the outcome of the dispute. You may seek interim relief before the court. Say, for example, an application in terms of Order 39, Rule 1 and 2 of the CPC, where a plaintiff could seek an injunction in respect of a property or in respect of a contract. Similarly, under the Arbitration Act, a party can claim interim relief before the court in terms of Section 9 of the Arbitration Act and before the tribunal in terms of Section 17 of the Arbitration Act. Section 9 of the Arbitration Act and the intricacies surrounding Section 9 would be dealt with by me later when I go to the court aspect of it. But as far as an arbitration tribunal is concerned, it is suffice to say that an arbitral tribunal can grant all those interim reliefs which a court can grant under Section 9. There was this dichotomy and there was this unusual scenario where it was assumed or it was found that Section 17 is not such an effective remedy and that Section 9 is a better remedy because it comes from a court and Section 17 is by the arbitrator. So to remove this, because if you read Section 9 and Section 17 of the Arbitration Act, both are almost verbatim. And the only reason why people would not seek it before an arbitral tribunal was supposed to be that it is not as effective as an interim order passed by the court under Section 9. So to remove this, amendments were made in 2015, and they said that an interim order passed by an arbitral tribunal is executable and enforceable as if it were an order passed by the court under Section 9. So therefore, after the amendments that have been made, there is no difference between an order passed by the arbitral tribunal or the order passed by a court under Section 9 of the Arbitration Act. An interim relief may be necessary for a variety of reasons. Say, for example, if you feel that the defendant or respondent is going to alienate his assets, or by the time you have an arbitral award in your favor, you would have nothing that you could enforce from or against the defendant, you could seek relief of furnishing security. Or if you think that if dispute relates to a property in question, so you may seek an injunction against alienation of such a property, which may depend on the facts and circumstances of every case. I've talked about pleadings. There's not much to talk about pleadings. But one important thing about pleadings is that the pleadings need not be very strictly in accordance with traditional rules of dispute resolution, in the sense that there are some contents of a plaint, some contents of a written statement. A plaint is liable to be rejected if it does not really disclose any cause of action. So a claim statement, on the other hand, in an arbitral process is not restricted by the limitations or the rigors of the civil procedure code. So therefore, even if you wish to amend your pleadings during the process of an arbitration, arbitrators are quite liberal about it, and the Arbitration Act wants the arbitrators to be quite liberal about it, unlike the rigors of Order 6, Rule 17 of the CPC, and so on and so forth. After pleadings, we come to this one very important aspect of evidence. I've already discussed about oral evidence and documentary evidence and how it is fairly advisable, and usually the scenario where disputes are decided on the basis of documents, and it is only in cases of complex transactions that oral evidence is even required to be led. One important feature of leading evidence before the arbitral tribunal is that the arbitral tribunal is not bound by the rigors of the Evidence Act also. So it does not have to be the technical objections that people take in a court litigation as regards the evidence adduced by a party need not be available in an arbitration forum. And therefore, technical objections, which are usually used as a delaying tactic in a court proceeding, is usually not available in an arbitral process. And a few advantages of having an arbitration process is also that you can have some expert determination in your arbitration process. You can call experts, etc., etc., where some provisions have been made where the arbitrators have the powers to call, say, Section 26 of the Arbitration Act, whereby they can invite experts on the basis of a request made by the party, or on the basis of if the arbitrator so feels that an expert is required to prove a particular point of fact or a law, he may call an expert. After evidence, of course, it is the last stage of an arbitration process, is an arbitral award. So what an award must contain and how an award is to be prepared is dealt with under Section 31. And when we discuss Section 31 of the Arbitration Act, we should also discuss Section 28 of the Arbitration Act. The Section 28 of the Arbitration Act basically talks about the rules which is applicable to an arbitral dispute. So as far as an arbitration which is governed by Indian law, or in domestic arbitration within the jurisdiction of India, shall have to be governed by the laws which are in force in India. And as far as an international commercial arbitration is concerned, it shall be decided by the lex contractus, which is the law governing the contract. And if the parties have chosen any law, they may choose English law, they may choose Malaysian law, they may choose Korean law. And the arbitral tribunal shall be bound to apply such law as has been agreed by the parties for the resolution of disputes. And if the parties have failed to designate any law governing the resolution of their disputes, there are, of course, rules of private international law, rules of conflict of laws that the arbitral tribunal shall be bound to apply for the resolution of such a dispute. And as far as an award is concerned, an award is dealt with under Section 31 of the Arbitration Act. It says what all is required. It shall be in writing. It shall be signed by the parties. And it shall be a reasoned award, etc., etc. And an arbitral award shall be, a signed copy shall be delivered to the parties. An arbitral award can make an interim award, it can make two interim awards, it can make one final award. So similarly, in a CPC proceeding, we have something called as a partial decree or final decree, preliminary decree, partly preliminary, partly final decree. So here also, by the arbitral tribunal has been empowered to make as many awards as it wants in the interest of the resolution of the dispute. And once an arbitral award is made, the arbitral tribunal's mandate stands terminated as per the Arbitration Act. And only if there is a need to correct the award for the reasons which is mentioned under the Arbitration Act, which is Section 33, where, say, a clerical error has to be corrected or a particular point of award has to be interpreted because it is not easily discernible by the parties, an arbitral tribunal may correct the award in terms of Section 33, which is, I think, equivalent to Section 152 of the CPC, where a civil court is empowered to correct clerical or arithmetical mistakes, etc. So that now we come to the end of the arbitration aspect of my presentation. Now we will come to the court. What is the role and functions of courts in our country, or generally even in an international commercial arbitration, as to the effective implementation of an arbitral process and for an effective arbitration process for the resolution of disputes. And in the beginning of my presentation, I had spoken about constitution of arbitral tribunals. And I had said that, say, if it is a sole arbitrator, parties would have to agree on the appointment of an arbitrator. And if they are not able to agree on the appointment of a sole arbitrator, there is a rescue under the Arbitration Act, which is Section 11 of the Arbitration Act. So in cases where parties are not able to agree on the appointment of a sole arbitrator, or in cases of, and an arbitration mechanism need not necessarily provide for a sole arbitrator, it can also provide for the appointment of multiple arbitrators. Say, for example, in case of a three-member arbitral tribunal, an agreement usually is that each of the parties would appoint an arbitrator each, and the arbitrators who have been so appointed would appoint the third arbitrator, or the third arbitrator would be appointed by someone. Parties can agree that so-and-so, say Kannan, can appoint the third arbitrator, will be the umpire, or they can agree that an arbitral institution shall appoint the third arbitrator, or they can agree that all the three arbitrators shall be appointed by the by an arbitral institution. They can agree whatever they want, because there is an element of party autonomy which has been put into the Arbitration Act based on the UN Citral Model Law, which is the United Nations Commission for International Trade Law. It came out with a model arbitration law in 1985. And it is on the basis of such a law that the Indian Arbitration Act of 1996 has also been enacted. And in cases of, say, such a situation where the parties are unable to agree on the appointment of an arbitrator or the sole arbitrator, or for any reason an arbitrator is not appointed, the parties have been given the right to approach the court under Section 11 of the Arbitration Act. So in cases of an International Commercial Arbitration Act, Section 11 says that it shall be before the Supreme Court. And in cases of a non-international commercial arbitration, I mean, I think it's very important at this stage that we speak about an international commercial arbitration and a non-international commercial arbitration. Because in our Arbitration Act, there is nothing called as a domestic arbitration. There is only an international commercial arbitration or a non-international commercial arbitration. So an international commercial arbitration has to be international in nature, and it has to have the commercial element attached to it, failing which it becomes a non-international arbitration, a non-international commercial arbitration. So in cases of non-international commercial arbitration, the court which is empowered to appoint the arbitrator is the High Court. So you can file an application in terms of Section 11 of the Arbitration Act and get the arbitrator appointed who has not yet been appointed. And the court will usually endeavor to act according to the agreement of the parties, and failing which it may appoint an arbitrator. The High Courts have a panel. Now we also have institutional arbitrations, which has been introduced in the Arbitration Act by way of the 2019 Amendment Act, where the High Courts and the Supreme Court have been given the power to designate arbitral institutions who meet the grade criteria fixed by the Arbitration Council. The next aspect of the involvement of courts in an arbitration process is Section 9. I discussed some amount of Section 9 and Section 17 in the beginning of my lecture. And the only thing that I need to tell you about Section 9 is that earlier, before the 2015 Amendment Act, people would not commence an arbitration. And even before commencing arbitration in terms of Section 21, they would obtain interim orders before the court in terms of Section 9 of the Act. And it would so happen that arbitration is never commenced, but interim orders are continuing for ages together, which of course did dilute the essence of arbitration and the real intention behind the parties to arbitrate the dispute. So to overcome all of that, in 2015, amendments were introduced to the Arbitration Act, whereby it was mandated that if an order is passed under Section 9, you would have to necessarily commence arbitration within a period of 90 days once you obtain an interim order in terms of Section 9. And the current judicial trend is that once an arbitral tribunal is constituted, the court will summarily dismiss a Section 9 and refer the parties or ask the party concerned to approach the arbitral tribunal in terms of Section 17 of the Arbitration Act. This is judicial trend today. Courts, because keeping in line with the objective of the Arbitration Act under Section 5, which seeks to limit judicial intervention, the trend today before courts in India is not to intervene in such matters and leave it to the wisdom and discretion of the arbitral tribunal to, if deemed appropriate, to pass an interim order in terms of Section 17. The next aspect of this presentation is termination of arbitrators. So there are two aspects to it. One is where an arbitrator is challenged by a party, say for reasons of independence or impartiality. There is a challenge procedure mentioned under the Arbitration Act. And according to the Arbitration Act, if an arbitrator is challenged on the grounds of independence or impartiality, the party concerned would have to necessarily make that challenge procedure before the arbitrator. And in the event that such a challenge procedure is unsuccessful, then the party would have to wait for the award to be made. And if that party which has challenged the arbitrator suffers an award, that party has been given the right to challenge such an award apart from the grounds mentioned under Section 34 of the Arbitration Act, which I will be dealing with later. It can also challenge such an award on the grounds of independence and impartiality. Now, secondly, the second aspect is the de facto or the de jure inability of an arbitrator to act as an arbitrator. So in case where an arbitrator is de facto or de jure unable to perform his functions as an arbitrator, the party concerned may file an application in terms of Section 14 of the Arbitration Act and get the mandate of the arbitrator terminated. Now this section, this interrelation between Section 13 and Section 14 has been subject to contrary decisions among so many high courts, and the interplay between Section 13 and Section 14 is not yet decided by the Supreme Court by way of an authoritative pronouncement. But suffice it is to say that some high courts have held that the independence and impartiality of an arbitrator is nothing but a de jure inability of an arbitrator to perform his functions as an arbitrator. So some high courts have held that if an arbitrator is found to be not independent and not impartial, his mandate can be terminated under Section 14 of the Arbitration Act. And the aspect of independence and impartiality of an arbitrator is very important, because what had happened was, until from 1996 when the Arbitration Act was enacted and until 2015, there was a trend where, say for example, a commercial contract involving the government, or a commercial contract involving a public sector undertaking, or a commercial contract where one of the parties does not have the bargaining power to negotiate an arbitration clause or an arbitration agreement, it would so happen that the government or the PSU or the power or the party with superior bargaining power would usually agree or force the other party to agree that the arbitrator for the resolution of disputes would be appointed by that party. Say, for example, today we may be entering into so many contracts. Say you enter into a contract with Airtel or Vodafone for buying a telephone connection or mobile connection. You'll see, if you'll concentrate and you'll see, the arbitration mechanism of those contracts would say that the arbitrator would be appointed by Airtel or Vodafone. So in that case, you have no option but to be bound by the award of such an arbitrator, which is usually be in favor of such parties who have appointed them. So to address this issue, Parliament brought in some amendments in Section 12, and they introduced 5th and the 7th schedule in the Arbitration Act, which provided for some forms of relationships, etc., where in terms of Section Schedule 5, an arbitrator could be challenged due to independence or impartiality. And in terms of Schedule 7, such of the arbitrators who are covered by Schedule 7 are prohibited to be appointed as arbitrator or to act as arbitrators. So I think it was quite a welcome change, in the sense that parties did not have to suffer an arbitral award at the hands of a person who had a financial interest or any other interest with that of one of the parties. So for example, in cases of, in my experience as an arbitration lawyer, I've seen that in PSUs, where a former employee or a former consultant is appointed as the arbitrator. So, and naturally, the tendency is to be biased towards the other party, and the tendency is to pass an award in favor of the party which is appointed. So to overcome these things, Section 12 was amended and 5th and 7th schedules of the Arbitration Act were introduced, so as to have an element of fair play even in an arbitration process which is a private process. And there have been instances, some Supreme Court judgments that you all can take a look of, where they have dealt with how and in what circumstances an arbitration arbitration judge, an arbitrator, can be disqualified or is prohibited from acting as an arbitrator. The next aspect is Section 27 of the Arbitration Act, which provides for an arbitration tribunal's power to seek assistance of a court of law for the purpose of evidence. Say it so happens that in some cases, despite a witness being summoned to give evidence in before an arbitral tribunal, those witnesses do not appear because of the fact that an arbitral tribunal cannot compel, being a private forum, cannot compel such witnesses to come and depose before it. So in those cases, unlike a court process where the court has the power to compel the attendance of witnesses, it was deemed necessary that there should be an enabling provision where the arbitral tribunal is able to approach the court or permit any of the parties to approach the court in terms of Section 27 for the purposes of evidence. So it is important because in some cases you may have a foreign party, you may have a party who is not willing to give evidence. In those circumstances, it is important that such an application is made by the arbitrator for the purpose of compelling the attendance of witnesses. Now, the next and the most important function that the courts play as far as an arbitration process is concerned is the power to review an arbitral award. And I say this with a lot of responsibility because one of the reasons why arbitration was such a failure in our country from 1996 until 2015 was because of the fact that a party would have gone through an entire process of arbitration thinking that basic principles of finality and the binding nature of an arbitral award would be followed is taken by surprise suddenly when a court in exercise of its powers under Section 34 of the Arbitration Act suddenly sets aside such an arbitral award. And the only recourse if an arbitral award is set aside is to go through that arbitration once again. So I think this was definitely not in the interest of agreeing to an arbitration process. And in cases where the arbitration process used to take more than 3-4 years or 5 years, it is quite frustrating for a party to go through such a process again. And it is with this view. So what was also happening in an arbitration process was people had started dealing with an arbitration as if it were a court trial, getting the matter adjourned for years together. And there were a lot of problems and arbitration was not working out to be as effective as they thought it would be. So there was also a provision introduced in 2015. Section 29 capital A, by which it was mandated that an arbitral tribunal shall pass an award within the period of 12 months from the date it enters upon reference and subject to some extensions as the act itself provided. Now coming to Section 34 of the Arbitration Act. Section 34 is an important provision because Section 34, as the headnote states, the headnote says application for setting aside an arbitral award. So unlike a court process where challenge to a judgment in an appeal would be to either correct the judgment in appeal or to modify it or to revise it or to reverse it, the only option available before the court exercising powers under Section 34 of the Arbitration Act is to set aside the award or uphold the award. There is no other way possible unlike an appellate court. An arbitral award can be set aside only for the reasons mentioned under Section 34. Now it's important, I have not read any section so far, but Section 34 is important, so I will just read it. Section 34 subsection 1 says recourse to a court against an arbitral award may be made only by way of an application for setting aside such an award in accordance with subsection 2 and subsection 3. Now, subsection 2 says that an arbitral award may be set aside if the party was under some incapacity, say for example the party was a lunatic or was not able to conduct the arbitration for any XYZ reason. Secondly, the arbitration agreement is not valid under the law to which the parties have subjected it, or failing any indication thereon under the law being in force. Number three, the party making the application was not given proper notice of the appointment of an arbitrator or of the arbitral proceedings, or was otherwise unable to present his case. So section 34(2)(a)(3) is nothing but a provision which reinforces the principle of natural justice. So to say that an arbitration process can be conducted or an award passed without the involvement of the other party would be an award which does not, or which will not pass muster in terms of section 34 of the Arbitration Act. The fourth ground is the arbitrate award deals with a dispute not contemplated by or not falling within the terms of submission to arbitration, or it contains decisions on matters beyond the scope of arbitration or scope of the submission to arbitration. So an arbitral award can only be in reference of those disputes which the parties have agreed to submit to the jurisdiction of the arbitrator and nothing beyond it. So ideally, when we have arbitration clauses today, in most of the commercial contracts that I have seen, you will see that the arbitration clause starts with the words, all disputes arising out of or in connection with this agreement shall be resolved through arbitration. So all disputes which arise in respect of an agreement shall have to be decided by arbitration. It is nothing left for courts to decide. But in cases of, say, tender contracts or in cases of PSU contracts where the government is the body, my experience has been that there is something called accepted matters. So they have some classification as to what disputes are referable to arbitration and what disputes are not referable to arbitration. So in those cases, if an arbitral tribunal ventures into a matter which has not been subjected to the to the arbitration tribunal for resolution of such a dispute, such an award, to the extent that it deals with accepted matters, would be liable to be set aside in terms of section 34. The fifth ground under subsection 2A is that the composition of the arbitral tribunal or the arbitral procedure was not in accordance with the agreement of the parties, unless such agreement was in conflict with the provision of this part from which the parties cannot derogate, and or failing such agreement was not in accordance with this part. So there is an element of party autonomy to it, where, see, there are some provisions of the Arbitration Act which are derogable in nature. There are some provisions of the Act which are not derogable in nature. Say, the parties cannot agree non-international commercial arbitration seated in India shall be governed by the laws of UK. Of course, it is not possible because both the parties are India. The parties have chosen to be governed by the lex arbitri or the seat to be in India. And they cannot now say that they shall be governed by the laws of UK for the purpose of resolution of the substantive disputes. So, but there are some provisions from which that the parties may derogate under the Arbitration Act. So, insofar as the award is in respect of those provisions of the Arbitration Act, and it is not in consonance with the agreement of the parties, in case it is derogable, then such an award is liable to be set aside in terms of 34(2)(a)(5). Now, apart from the grounds mentioned under subsection 2A, the other grounds mentioned under B are that the subject matter of the dispute is not capable of settlement by arbitration under the law for the time being in force. So this provision, in fact, reinforces the principle of arbitrability in arbitration. So there are only certain matters which can be arbitrated. Say, for example, corruption matters cannot be decided by arbitration, or constitutional matters cannot be decided by arbitration, criminal matter cannot be decided by arbitration, or aspects involving state not on the commercial side or in say on respect of constitutional matters or in respect of legal matters where the state is involved, cannot be arbitrator. An arbitration mechanism is usually taken recourse to in commercial matters and in cases of international arbitration, for example, say treaty matters, say a bilateral investment treaty, there's a dispute around that, can be referred to arbitration. The second one under B is that the arbitral award is in conflict with the public policy of India. Now, what is the extent to which an award may be held to be in conflict with the public policy of India is being dealt with in so many cases. And so if any arbitral award which affects the public policy of India to the extent that it affects the sovereignty of India or the security of India, or it is not acceptable according to the Indian legal framework, shall be opposed to the public policy of India, and there are many judgments to this effect. The next matter is that it is in contravention with the fundamental policy of Indian law, and the next aspect is that it is conflict with the most basic notions of morality or justice. And there is also an explanation added to this. It says that for the avoidance of doubt, the test as to whether there is a contravention with the fundamental policy of Indian law shall not entail a review on the merits of the dispute. Now, what was happening was the approach of the courts dealing with a petition under Section 34 was when they would say that an award is in contravention to the fundamental policy of India, they would review the merits of the case. And in exercising its powers under Section 34 of the Arbitration Act, the court is not supposed to act like an appellate court so as to entail a review on merits. So because this was a trend being generally followed by courts in India, Parliament thought it fit to add this explanation. And in the 2015 amendment, Section 2A was also added to say that an arbitral award arising out of arbitrations other than international commercial arbitration may also be set aside by the court if the court finds that the award is vitiated by patent illegality appearing on the face of the award, provided that an award shall not be set aside merely on the ground of an erroneous application of the law or by reappreciation of the evidence. So, the concept of patent illegality was first introduced in India by the Supreme Court in the ONGC versus Sawpipes judgment, where they said that an arbitral award, when on the face of it is patently illegal, or in some other jurisdictions as they use it, obviously wrong on facts or on law, shall be set aside. So this in the 2015 Amendment Act, the principle of patent illegality, which was expounded by the Supreme Court in the Sawpipes case, has got legislative backing, and it's got statutory backing now in the form of Section 2A of Section 34 of the Arbitration Act. And Section 3, subsection 3-4 talks about what is the time limitation period for filing an application under Section 34 of the Arbitration Act. I will not go into it. The last provision that I would be dealing with is Section 36 and Section 37. Section 36 is the provision which is nothing but provisions in respect of a civil court judgment under Order 21 of the CPC relating to executions. Under 36 of the Arbitration Act, the word used is not execution but enforcement. So an arbitral award is enforced in terms of Section 36 of the Arbitration Act, and the process for filing an enforcement proceeding is very similar to that of Section Order 21 of the Civil Procedure Code, and that is also fortified by the provision itself in subsection 1, where it says that by the time for making an application to set aside the arbitral award under 34 has expired, then subject to the provisions of subsection 2, such award shall be enforced in accordance with the provisions of the Code of Civil Procedure 1908 in the same manner as if it were a decree of the court. So, an arbitral award is enforceable and executable in the same manner as if it were a decree of the court passed in terms of the provisions of the Civil Procedure Code. So there is no difference. In fact, there are multiple Supreme Court judgments now which says that you don't have to go through an enforcement proceeding separately and an execution proceeding separately. And all of that can be filed by way of one process where you just file an execution and you get the arbitral award enforced. Only one important aspect that I would like to deal with is that Section 36 was amended in 2015 again to say that earlier what used to happen was as soon as a petition under Section 34 prior to the 2015 amendment, when an application for setting aside an arbitral award is made, there was an automatic stay of against enforcement of the of such an arbitral award against which a Section 34 has been filed. Now, because of the fact that commercial interests were getting vitiated and because the arbitration was not working out to be so effective, there was a proviso added in 36(3) to state that in respect of an arbitration award, which is a money decree or a money award, such a money award shall not be stayed, because now unlike the position prior to 2015 where there was an automatic stay, now there is the necessity for a party to make an application for stay or an injunction against the enforcement of such award. And in so far as such an arbitral award deals with a money decree or a money award, such an award shall not be stayed unless the party seeking such an interim order or such an interim stay deposits such amounts as the court may direct the party to do so in terms of the provisions of the CPC. For example, even in a money decree which is appealed in a court of law will usually impose, a court of appeal would usually impose restriction as to how much money is to be deposited before ordering stay of the execution of the arbitral award. So now what has happened is all money claims and all commercial disputes, which are usually money claims, have the certainty of for the award holder to receive at least some amount of money before the Section 34 application is finally decided and disposed of by the court exercising powers under 34. And it is a welcome change to the extent that there is more confidence in the as regards receiving money. And especially for international investors who arbitrate their disputes in India, if there is uncertainty as to receiving the money, we will not get investments. So under pressure from various sectors and under pressure from legal practitioners as such and legal luminaries, it was deemed appropriate to import the provisions for stay of a money decree, even in cases of arbitral awards, by way of amendment to Section 36 of the Arbitration Act. And with this, I will conclude my presentation. I thank Vidhi Portal.com once again for giving me this opportunity. I am delighted.
Question and answer session.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. No, it is only as regards my presentation. I am not stopping anyone from having any questions. Thank you, everyone, for your patient hearing. It was a delightful experience to be featured on Vidhi Portal.com. I thank you all for attending this presentation. If anyone has any question, and if I'm able to, I'll.
I have allowed participants to. Participants can unmute themselves if they have any questions.
Hello.
Yes.
Hi. This is Shobhita.
Hi, Shobhita.
Thank you for that detailed presentation that you gave, which was really very very fundamental for anyone to understand arbitration. However, I wanted to ask a question. Could you please elaborate or explain more about one public policy? Because like you are someone who is into practice. So I just wanted to ask if you could just elaborate a bit on what Indian courts think about public policy and how they have decided upon public policy. And second, what about the dispute on the word international? I mean...
Absolutely. International commercial arbitration, right?
International part of international commercial arbitrations. What arbitrations are considered as international by...
Absolutely. Thank you, Shobhita. I'll answer your question. So I think the first case as regards public policy was Renu Sagar Power versus General Electric. And it was one of the first cases in the Supreme Court where it was said that an award which is against public policy would be an award that was passed in contravention of fundamental policy of Indian law or in the interests of India or justice or morality. But what happened was the ONGC versus Sawpipes judgment came later, which I discussed as regards the patent illegality aspect. It said that the court, in case of an application filed in terms of Section 34 to set aside an award, the role was similar to an appellate or a revisional court. And therefore, it said that it had wide powers. And the court added a new ground apart from this, which was also called patent illegality, which is also now found legislative backing. And what it quite did was that it opened a floodgate of litigation under Section 34. And every award where there was an error in respect of the decision of the arbitration of the arbitrator was challenged, and every award was automatically getting stayed anyway in terms of Section 34. And so it was creating a lot of problems. And what also happened was in another case, which is ONGC, I think, versus Western Geco, it said that, relying on Sawpipes case again, and noted that the judgment was silent on the meaning of fundamental policy of Indian law. And it therefore went on to interpret fundamental policy of Indian law to say that an arbitral tribunal must have a judicial approach, which was not was contemplated by the either by the model law in 1985 or by the Arbitration Act in 1996, because it only wanted a decision, a process involving a process of adjudication, sticking to some international norms of arbitration dispute, and not some judicial approach which we are quite accustomed to in India. And not only did this judgment open a Pandora box again, but what happened was that awards started getting set aside for the reason that it did not have a judicial approach. And therefore, the concept of public policy was, apart from the fact that security and sovereignty of India, interests of India, justice and morality, etc., and also patent illegality, which was added by Sawpipes. In Western Geco, they added one more policy, that one more ground, that if an award does not meet the standards of judicial approach, such an award is liable to be set aside. And to overcome all of these things is the reason why the amendments in 2015 were made to Section 34. And I think the another one important case that I have read was the case of Associate Builders versus Delhi Development Authority. What had happened was, if I remember correctly, Associate Builders versus Delhi Development Authority was one case where the single judge, I think presided by Justice Sanjay Kishan Kaul, who is now the now a Supreme Court judge, he had upheld an award on the basis of the parameters laid down for setting it aside in terms of Section 34. But when the matter was taken on appeal in terms of Section 37 of the Arbitration Act, the division bench, which was presided by Justice Pradeep Nandarjog, who retired as the Chief Justice of Bombay High Court, had gone into several intricacies surrounding the award, calculations, etc., and the award was set aside by the division bench of the Delhi High Court. And when the matter was taken to the Supreme Court, the judgment was authored by Justice Rohinton Nariman. And he says, and he, of course, obviously, set aside the judgment of the Delhi High Court, Division Bench Delhi High Court, which had gone into reappreciating the evidence, etc. And if you will read that judgment, there was a very famous quotation of Lord Mansfield, which was quoted there. He quotes that few words of Lord Mansfield. He was once advising apparently a general, a military general, who had to decide on a particular case. And he said that, "General, hear the parties patiently and write your heart out in the judgment that you would give. But never give reasons for such a judgment, because although your decision may be correct, but the reasons you give for arriving at such a decision may be obviously wrong." So Justice Nariman took a dig at the Division Bench of the Delhi High Court for going into, although the arbitral award had been set aside by the Division Bench, the Supreme Court reminded the Division Bench of the Delhi High Court that reappreciating the evidence or going beyond what the arbitrators had held would be an error and would be impermissible within the scope of Section 34 of the Arbitration Act. So I think DDA versus Associate Builders versus DDA quite reinforced the position once again in India that an award could be set aside only in terms of Section 34 of the Arbitration Act, which also includes public policy. And public policy generally means that it shall not be against the interests of India. It shall not be against the security and sovereignty of India. It shall not be against justice or morality or basic notions of justice, which has also got legislative backing. And fourthly, which is obviously wrong or patent illegality, or now the Section 2A, which has been introduced in Section 34, is that an award can be set aside only if it is obviously wrong on facts or in law on the face of it. And the proviso makes it very clear that when you are reviewing a judgment or an arbitral award as regards patent illegality, you shall not go to the merits of the dispute to say that an award is patent illegal. I hope I answered your question, Shobhita.
Yes, Kannan.
Thank you. International, I think that international aspect is also very close to my heart, because I was practicing in the Madras High Court. It's a very interesting question of law, and I think it's very important for all our lawyer friends to know about it. In that case, I will tell you what had happened. The client, who was the claimant in the arbitration, had approached us to file a Section 11 application. The contract involved our client, which was who was an Indian party. The contract had his employer, which was an Indian company registered in terms of the Companies Act. It also had an American party, which was nothing but the parent company of the Indian company. So it was an employment contract which had the Indian employee, which had an Indian company as also an American company. So what happened when we filed the petition? The respondents raised an objection to state that this is an international commercial arbitration because of the fact that there is an international element to it. So that brings us to the definition of international in terms of the Arbitration Act. Let us take what is an international commercial arbitration. Section 2.1F. International commercial arbitration means an arbitration relating to disputes arising out of legal relationships, whether contractual or not, considered as commercial under the law in force in India, and where at least one of the parties is an individual who is a national of or habitually resident in any country other than in India, a body corporate which is incorporated in any country other than India, or an association or a body of individual whose central management and control is exercised in any other country apart from India, or the government of a foreign country. So even if one party to the agreement, or to the arbitration agreement to be precise, is a foreign party, such an arbitration would be called an international commercial arbitration as long as there is a commercial element attached to it. So we successfully argued in that matter that an employment contract is not a commercial contract. We had discussed some case laws from the from Canada, from the House of Lords, to state that an employment contract can never be considered to be a commercial contract, and therefore the arbitration in the present case is a non-commercial international arbitration, a non-international commercial arbitration, and not an international commercial arbitration. Because those are the only two kinds of arbitration which is contemplated under the Indian Arbitration Act.
Okay, Tanan, thank you so much.
Yes.
We'll be launching our website, so we'll be starting our website soon. So I think we are ending this one session. Anyone has something to say? And participant, if you understand.
Anyone has any questions, you can please shoot out an email to me. I will be more than happy. I think we're running out of time here. And thank you once again, everyone, for joining this session. Thank you, Vidhi Portal.com for organizing this.
And if people want to see the website, I'll just take 2 minutes to show the website.
Yeah. Sure. We'll be.
Just 2 minutes. Just 2 minutes. I'm starting my web.
Sure.
Can see the website.
No, we can't.
Is the website visible?
No, it's not visible.
Yes, we can.
Is
thank
it visible
you.
Now?
Yeah.
Okay. So this is the website. Previously we were in WordPress. Hello, pehle WordPress pe kaam kar rahe the, and now we have shifted to the version developed by Minds Infotech Private Limited. This is the company is Minds Infotech. And right now, बहुत सारे updates नहीं थे there were like judgments you want to see. आप इसमें you can just search here. Like if it's a bail case or if it's a tender case. You can यहाँ पे you can search this thing. The latest course will be coming here यहाँ पे and we have also that what we are into is we also make video blogs, small blogs. You can see our blogs by clicking here. If you are interested in working with us, there is a career section you can mail to us and this is the basic starting. It says starting we need to add lot of elements into this website, so we are working on it. And I think just if someone can have any questions, they can add themselves.
So do we get like regular updates on what happens in courts around the day, like bar and bench and live law? Does Vidhi Portal.com also have some section for news updates or some legal updates on a daily basis?
On daily basis, what right now we have done is you can put your email address in it. We'll be sending you the daily updates. But right now we are covering up. We started from Jharkhand, and we are into we are Jharkhand, Odisha, Bihar, and Chhattisgarh. This is the first phase where we are working on it. All right. So, and
I think it's very important that the decisions of Jharkhand, Odisha. Patna is also, people are aware of these judgments passed by these high courts also. Thank you.
And the first thing and the rest is if someone wants to continue, we will continue in like, we'll start how we started and who is working on our team. And the third is what's next we'll be doing. So if please unmute yourself and, we want to have a video discussion with everyone. So please, Ashwin, Amit Bhaiya, Amit Kumar. Sultan, everyone, please unmute
yourself. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Ashwin, hello. Supriya.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
So yeah, like first we, I think the reason behind this, when I was in the court, like when the court hearing is going on, so I used to see, hota kya tha, there were many submissions that the both petitioners used to make, both petitioners and the respondent used to make. Those submissions are just, you know, they were never reported. Those submissions never get reported. And then I realized we need a forum, you know, for Jharkhand, the other states, which we don't get a lot of legal reporting from these area. So this is how I started. Right now, I started main khud se hi kaam kar raha tha, and then I got a help from the intern Supriya. She's from Kids University, and then now Supriya is working with us. And the videos, all the concept of the videos, I got help from Amit Kumar, Anush Kumar Tiveri, Amritansh, Sultan Khan, and everyone. So, and the next stage will be going. We are looking for more platforms to work to expand our work. So I think those people who are able to speak, and you know, you can start with Supriya. Supriya, you tell me how like you find the work here. Supriya is interning with us.
Basically, we give legal updates. We invite many eminent lawyers to speak on the legal topics and also the debatable topics that is going in our country, like CAA. We have been publishing judgments, like so the people are updated. And basically, what we are doing is we are making 27 of 51 pages judgments into 3-page judgment, and we give you the crux of the material. Like we give you the facts, the arguments of the opposite parties, the judgment, and what were the precedents on which the court relied on, and what we got from those precedents, and how the court decided on the matter. Then we direct you to videos, informative videos on legal matters. Like today, I think we have published, or we are going to publish, on patriarchy. We have uploaded a video.
Prem, may I interrupt? Prem.
हाँ,
वो फेसबुक पे नहीं आ रहा है फ्रेम ये वाला, वो स्क्रीन का आ रहा है फेसबुक पे.
ओके ओके ओके.
जो लाइव देख रहे हैं वो लोगों को नहीं दिख रहा.
ओके अभी आ रहा
है. हाँ ओके.
आई थिंक हमने दिखा दिया. सो यू यू आई मीन वी आर जस्ट सीकिंग ओपिनियंस. आप कुछ बताना चाहते हैं तो प्लीज थोड़ा अपना शेयर करें.
हेलो.
हाँ अमित भाई, आप, आई थिंक अमित भैया का मैं इंट्रोड्यूस कराना चाहता हूँ. जब स्टार्टिंग में हमने वीडियो बनाया तो अमित सर वाज द फर्स्ट वन हु केम टू मेक अ वीडियो. आई थिंक आप भी कुछ अपना, यू कैन पुट योर एक्सपीरियंस अराउंड हियर.
पहले तो सबसे पहले तुमको बहुत बहुत कॉन्ग्रेट्स कि ये शॉर्ट ड्यूरेशन में इतना अच्छा एक वेबसाइट आज लॉन्च की हो, प्लस अपना यूट्यूब चैनल भी लॉन्च करने जा रहे हो. और ये जहाँ तक हम लोग के जर्नी का बात करें तो जर्नी हम लोग का लॉकडाउन इमिडिएटली जैसे जब हुआ था 18th of March आई थिंक, उस समय तुम्हारे मन में ये आइडिया आया था बिकॉज सारा चीज सेटअप हो चुका था और कुछ करने को आदमी के पास नहीं था. एक ही जो जरिया था सोशली कनेक्टेड होने का वो सोशल मीडिया था और ये वेबिनार और जूम ऐप के थ्रू था. तो ये तुम्हारे मन में ये आइडिया आया और ये बहुत ही इम्पोर्टेंट आइडिया था तुम्हारे मन में, जिसमें बहुत लोगों को हेल्प मिला और इससे आने वाले जनरेशन को, न्यू लॉ स्टूडेंट को और प्लस जो यंग लॉयर्स है उन लोग को भी मदद मिलेगा कि लेटेस्ट अपडेट जो हमारे कोर्ट में हो रहा है, स्पेशली झारखंड में. अभी फिलहाल तो हम झारखंड की ही बात करेंगे बिकॉज ये तुम्हारा जो वेबसाइट है वो स्पेसिफिक अभी झारखंड में ही है, तो इसमें काफी हेल्प मिलेगा. हम लोग का शुभकामना है, बस यही है. धन्यवाद. थैंक यू.
सुल्तान,
फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल कॉन्ग्रेचुलेशन प्रेम कि आपका वेबसाइट लॉन्च हो गया और यूट्यूब चैनल भी लॉन्च हो जाएगा अभी कुछ देर में. तो ये विधि पोर्टल के बारे में मैं बताऊं थोड़ा सा. ये एक उभरता हुआ लीगल जर्नलिज्म का नॉर्थ ईस्ट में, इंडिया के नॉर्थ ईस्ट में ये सबसे फास्टेस्ट ग्रोइंग है, अभी तक मैंने किसी को नहीं देखा इतना फास्ट ग्रो करते हुए। ये विधि पोर्टल उड़ीसा, बिहार, पटना, बिहार, झारखंड, उड़ीसा, छत्तीसगढ़ और कोलकाता, इन सब में इतना फास्ट ये ग्रो कर रहा है, मतलब बियॉन्ड एक्सपेक्टेशन है ये। तो विधि पोर्टल को मेनी मेनी कांग्रेचुलेशंस कि इतने कम वक्त में, वो भी लॉकडाउन के पीरियड में, टेक्नोलॉजी का यूज करके लीगल जर्नलिज्म में इतना ज्यादा ग्रो करना, ये काबिले तारीफ है। मैं मुबारकबाद देता हूँ प्रेम को और उनकी पूरी टीम को। और इसमें एक और बात है कि जब विधि पोर्टल ने इंटर्नशिप के लिए ओपनिंग की थी तो बहुत सारे लोग इंटर्नशिप के लिए कूद पड़े, उसमें से ये एक मेरे से जो कनेक्टेड है सुप्रिया, उसको मिला इंटर्नशिप के लिए। ये एक बहुत हाईली कॉम्पिटेटिव इंटर्नशिप की जॉब वैकेंसी थी, जिसमें कि विधि पोर्टल में आप समझ सकते हैं कि कितने लोग इसमें अप्लाई कर रहे हैं इंटर्नशिप के लिए, और अभी भी लोग अप्लाई कर रहे हैं। मुझे पर्सनली मैसेज करते हैं कि सर उसको अप्लाई कैसे करना है, विधि पोर्टल में कैसे ज्वाइन करना है। तो इससे ये पता चलता है कि विधि पोर्टल कितना ज्यादा स्टूडेंट्स में, लॉ स्टूडेंट्स में और यंग लॉयर्स जो अभी एनरोल कराए हैं उन लोगों में कितना फेमस हो चुका है विधि पोर्टल इतने कम वक्त में। ये बहुत बहुत मुबारक हो प्रेम आपको, और अब तो ऑफिशियल वेबसाइट आ चुकी है, तो इसमें और भी बहुत सारे डेवलपमेंट्स होंगे। बहुत बहुत मुबारक हो और शुभकामनाएं आपको है कि और भी आप इसमें ग्रो कीजिए। मैं चाहता हूं कि आप इंडिया लेवल पे और ज्यादा काम कीजिए, अभी तो फिलहाल नॉर्थ ईस्ट कवर हो रहा है, तो और भी कवर कीजिएगा। इससे बहुत फायदा हो रहा है, इससे मुझे पर्सनली क्या फायदा हुआ, मैं अपना पर्सनल एक्सपीरियंस बता रहा हूँ कि हम लोग लाइव लॉ, बार बेंच और भी बहुत सारे जो पोर्टल्स है उसमें देखते हैं तो ज्यादातर दिल्ली हाईकोर्ट, बॉम्बे हाईकोर्ट के जजमेंट्स मिलते हैं, बट एज अ प्रैक्टिसिंग लॉयर लोकल वर्जन में हमें नहीं मिल पाता है। यहाँ पे विधि पोर्टल एक वैक्यूम में अपना जगह क्रिएट कर ली है, तो इससे हमें जो जजमेंट चाहिए जो हमारे केसेस में जो यूज करने के लिए, वहां पे विधि पोर्टल यहाँ पे एकदम फिट, परफेक्ट और एकदम सटीक जजमेंट्स हमको शॉर्ट में देती है। ज्यादा नहीं, अब 50 पेज का है तो हम 50 पेज तो पढ़ने का उतना बहुत मुश्किल होता है, तो 3 पेज में, 2 पेज में विधि पोर्टल इतनी जल्दी दे देती है। और शॉर्टनेस, उसका जो पंच लाइन यूज करती है विधि पोर्टल, इतनी खूबसूरत यूज करती है, तो इसके वजह से मुझे लगता है कि ये बहुत ही ग्रो करने वाली है विधि पोर्टल। और प्रेम, आपको फिर से एक बार तहे दिल से बहुत बहुत मुबारक हो कि आपकी ऑफिशियल वेबसाइट आ गई है, और सबको मुबारक हो, आपकी पूरी टीम को मुबारक।
Karan, hello, Karan. Supriya, just a hold on.
Karan, can you hear us? Yeah, can I talk? Is it my turn?
Karan, there. It's better. Karan, just stay for 5 minutes. The I have a question that was posted in the Facebook, so we'll answer to that question. But Supriya, can you tell us, like, I think I got a lot of application, but the kind of candidate I'm looking is. We face a lot of credible candidate to work with, because the kind of work we do is very hard to find those human resources. So I think Supriya can tell us, like, what future person, you know, if people are interested in working with us, what can be, you know, the eligible qualities that should have.
Like, for the interview, I had to submit a good write-up, a good poster for the write-up, and a video to show my speaking skills and to show my comfort in front of the camera. So I gave my 100% as Sultan sir recommended me. So I wanted to show his trust in my work. So I wrote it in a very structured way. I gave the video, I practiced a bit for that, so that I can perform good in front of the video and to give my best. And to any future candidate looking forward to it, I think they can contact us as to what we are looking for, so they can get a clear idea. As sir told me that many people couldn't understand, like, what they were looking for. So we are basically looking for for someone to understand the judgments, to understand what the court is trying to say, and to convey it to the people in a very short way, so the lawyers can get the crux of the matter. Like, if I'm a busy lawyer, I don't want to go through a 60 pages judgment. I just want to see whether or not it will help in my case. So I can just go through the website and I can see, okay, there is a website. It will help me in Prevention of Corruption Act. now it talks about section 20. So I can look up in the matter, I can see what all the judgments of the Supreme Court were cited in the matter. So through my write-up, I try to convey all the important points in that. And soon we are going to launch our YouTube channel, and we will give you the review of all the judgments and all the stories that we have updated on website, because some people don't mostly read. They mostly try to get updates through videos, so they can subscribe to our video channels, our YouTube channel. That's all. Hello. That's all.
Thank you, Supriya. Where is Prem? I think some technical glitches there.
Yes.
I need to call. What happened? Network problem.
Hello.
Yeah.
Kanan, so the thing I just lost the meeting. Because of the issue. Okay. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
So the question is, there's some question by Ritu Ranjan Sharma, Facebook. She question is, please underline the difference.
Yeah. I can't hear you, Prem. Prem, you have been muted, please. I can't hear you. You have been muted. Vidhi portal icon has been muted.
Hello, now can you hear me?
Yeah.
So the question is, please underline the differences between international commercial arbitration proceeding and non-international arbitration proceeding once again, and their concerned section and their split of influence.
Okay. So as far as the difference between international commercial arbitration and non-international commercial arbitration is concerned, statutorily, under the Arbitration Act 1996, a non-international commercial arbitration is not defined. What is defined under the Arbitration Act is an international commercial arbitration. So, disputes which are international commercial arbitration are those cases which fall within the definition which I quoted. I will do so once again. And all other cases which are not international in commercial arbitration are to be considered as non-international commercial arbitration. I'll deal with it again. Section 2, subsection 1, clause F. International commercial arbitration means an arbitration. Number one, an arbitration relating to disputes arising out of legal relationships, whether are contractual or not, considered as commercial under the law in force in India. So first thing, for a particular arbitration to be considered as international commercial arbitration, the first and most essential requirement is that such an arbitration is arising out of a commercial legal relationship. And cases which do not meet this fundamental criteria, which is a sine qua non for the purposes of meeting the definition under Section 21F of the Arbitration Act, an arbitration which does not have, or the underlying contract which does not have any commercial element attached to it, is not an International Commercial Arbitration Act. See, for the purposes of commercial dispute, what I think is that although the Arbitration Act came in 1996, we have the benefit of the Commercial Courts Act now. And under the Commercial Courts Act, it is defined as to what kind of disputes are commercial disputes. So in my opinion, a dispute or an arbitration which is falling within the definition of a commercial dispute under, even under the Commercial Courts Act, could be taken to be a commercial arbitration for the purposes of Section 21F. And apart from the underlying relationship being commercial in nature, it is very important that one of the parties to the such an arbitration is an individual who is a national of, or even someone who is a habitual resident of a country other than India, number one, or it is a body corporate which is incorporated in any other country other than in India. Number three, an association or a body of individuals whose central management and control is exercised in any other country other than in India. Say, for example, FIFA or the Olympics Association, which does not have its central management in India, would be meeting the definition of an international commercial arbitration. And number four, the government of a foreign country. So, for example, if there were to be a commercial arbitration between, say, a party from India and a government of a foreign country, would be an international commercial arbitration, provided the relationship between such parties is commercial in nature. And all of the cases we have to assume are deemed to be non-international commercial law, commercial arbitration.
Okay, so Ritu Ranjan Sharma has another question. What is the influence of Arbitration Act as far as non-international arbitration disputes are concerned in the domestic domain? Please elaborate in the context of domestic arena.
Okay, see, the reason why the Arbitration Act is there in our country is to definitely regulate the process of arbitration, because an arbitral process cannot go unregulated, because ultimately it affects the rights and duties of parties, and it has to have an enforceable character. So it is most important that there is a regulatory framework which is present for the purposes of regulating the arbitration process in India. And as far as the specific question here is concerned, as to what is the contribution of the domestic arbitration law for the purposes of governing non-international commercial arbitrations, I think an arbitration cannot possibly work without some amount of statutory backing. Say, for example, even in cases of how an arbitrator is to be appointed, or what to do in case an arbitrator is not being agreed to be appointed between the parties, there has to be some recourse, or for example, to replace an arbitrator, or for the purposes of obtaining interim relief even before an arbitral process is commenced, so as to protect the rights and interests of parties, and so that tomorrow an arbitral award is not does not result in a paper decree or a paper award. It is important that a statutory framework is in place whereby the trust and the confidence in arbitration that people have is restored. And for the purposes of that, our Indian Arbitration Act of 1996 has been enacted, for providing for various forms of protection and rights that the parties enjoy. I've already discussed all the legal provisions ranging from interim relief to appointment of arbitrators to the powers of a court exercising jurisdiction under Section 34 of the Arbitration Act, or the courts which exercises jurisdiction under Section 36 of the Arbitration Act. I think I have nothing further to add on this.
There are a few comments, so I'll mention those comments. Ritu Ranjan Sharma says, congratulations, flag bearers of the legal arena in our millennia. Madhuram Aprajita says, Lords Mansfield was an interesting mention. Shabas says, good job, Mr. Kannan. That's it.
Thank you. Thank you, Vidhi Portal. Thank you, Prem, especially for organizing this. Thank you, everyone who took the time out, their precious time out to participate in this webinar. And
Rahul Miranda is also there, I think. He's not replying. We can conclude.
Thank you very much. It was a delight. Namaste.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chalo. We are ending this.